So, realizing that that has absolutely nothing to do with what I was going to talk about, for this video, I'm going to actually play the piece first. And then talk about it again. This is another video about how learning classic country intros, these really recognizable lines, can help you improvise freely and musically on the fretboard. The song is Drink Up and Be Somebody. I'm going to want to talk about the Roy Nichols sound. So before I talk about it, we'll hear it. This was originally, half of this is done on a pedal steel. So if you were going to do it on a six string, it would be something like this. And it goes to a verse. And I'm just going to let this roll because there's a part at the end of the chorus which does this sound that I'm going to be talking about. And then it goes into that intro again. So I'll just sort of let it roll, and then play through the intro, then we'll stop. So this is still the verse, D, C, here's the chorus. It's a 1-4-5, this is G. Be somebody, I'll have another round. I can't let my troubles find you. I gotta keep your memory down. I can't let you drive me crazy. All right. I gotta drink up, be somebody again. Goes into another verse and a chorus and does that ending, that again, I think into a something, some sort of ending like that. So, first off, the Roy Nichols sound. A lot of players have a signature riff or a signature a phrase that they do, but he did this thing. It was really just one note. And I know you know this, but all alone, a note doesn't really mean anything, right? A note really only takes on meaning when it is heard relative to another note or notes. So you take that note, so that's a D. And so you think, oh, this is the key of D. But because it's just on its own. If I were to play this, that's B flat major, but there's that D, right? It's the major three of B flat. Or for that matter, B minor, because there's that note again. Even more of an unlikely stretch, I could be playing, you know, an E7, and, right? There's that same note there. So the note only means something relative to another note. And that was the magic of this one note that he did. Keep in mind, at the time, it was such a jarring sound that people thought it was a mistake. And the it that I'm talking about is landing on the dominant seventh. And the most pure and in-your-face simple version of this is the intro to Mama Tried, right? It's in D. And the opening line, and you think it would be, right? Like Mary Had a Little Lamb. It's beautifully over D. It's not what he does. He goes, and lands on that dominant seven. Now he doesn't do it that lame. He does it with a cool, you know, does it again, an octave lower. And then the chord comes in. So it is this decision to land on the dominant seven, which is a whole step below the note that your ear thinks it's going to, that kind of gives you that pull. And this became kind of a signature thing. He did it in Mama Tried, he did it in Lonesome Fugitive, he did it in bunches of songs, but this song here, it happens a lot. And the whole point here is that while you're learning these melodies, that you're seeing the chords that inform those melodies. These melodies come directly from very standard chord shapes. That's the point. So instead of just drilling all of the different inversions of a C major chord, you play a song that has the C major chord and a melody that comes from it. Just like the techniques, instead of working on bending your strings, you take a line like this that has a lot of string bending, right? So you're learning the technique while using it in a musical way. Your brain will make connections if you learn enough of these. So that's a lot of talking there. Let me show you what I'm... give you an example of that. So the song, it's in G, and I'm thinking of this G shape and that G shape, like that right there. The pickup is, or you could even go, right? Either way, I'm just trying to go to that G major shape. There it is. That's, there they are, the one, the three, and the five. And then, that note right there, that's that seven. There's the two. And then, there's that seven, again. And then, into C, thinking of that chord, it's... And then, instead of C, it's landing on that dominant seven, so... In the D, there it is again, and there it is again, and then C, that's just a, and that's G, I'm thinking of that G. So it's those are the shapes. That G is what I'm aiming for in the intro. And then that C. But again, wherever you do these shapes now, you want to add, where is the seven? There it is. In the D. There's the seven. There's the seven. That's the idea, that you see these shapes, but instead of just doing the one, the three, and the five, you now know where that dominant seven is. Then it does the chorus, and when it goes to the D, there it is again, right? That, there it is. That's the seven of D. And, that's twice in that one little bar, and then the G. That's just... You're just thinking of that, that G chord. Then it goes back to the intro again. See, there's that seven. There's the seven of C. That, by the way, you're in C. Guess what note that is? Yeah, it's the seven of C. So, it's kind of like the fourth note now to add to these. If you've been, Guthrie Trapp has all these videos about triads, just the importance of knowing these triads, knowing the inversions. Play a really simple three-chord song like Wild Thing, right? But every single time you hit the chord, play a different inversion of it. And you wouldn't want to perform that for anybody because it's kind of silly. But to just use a musical context to practice different inversions, will help you see how you can stitch it all together, and you can then play musically over the chords. I hope that made sense. Use this one to start getting really familiar with where your dominant seven is. Add that to your triads. This melody will really help you see it. I'll try to post the backing track that I was using too. I've been saying that for a while. I need to post these. So I hope that helps, and enjoy it.